All right, down in front, down in front. Time to get going. Good morning. I'm Don Schroeder. I'm your councilman of the day. Most people call me Bear. The Sky Pilot says it's time we go, so we're going to go. There's a few things in the bulletin you should recognize. So one of them is the fact that next week there's going to be the blessing of packs, backpacks. So if you have a child or a child all the way up into college, I mean, I've got a friend, he's my age, and he's going back to school and finishing up for his doctorate degree. So you can be any age, bring your backpack and have them blessed. Our backpack program, as far as feeding the young ones, has started, and you're going to hear more about that later. I was amazed, though, when I read about this. They started off with 11 people, 11 kids, and now they're serving 65. So to me, that says, God says, I want this to keep going. So if you can help, it would be appreciated. I also have another little thing. This is not coming up just right now, but I want everybody to start thinking about it. We are going to have council people that are leaving, okay? So we will have to have people that go on the council. Now, you're going, no. This is going to be great this year. You've got to remember, we're bringing in a new pastor. COVID should be getting over with. And so it should be an exciting time to get on the council. So everybody think about it. A few weeks ago, I had talked about praying for our Richland County Sheriff's Department. I still have more people here that I need people to take and pray for them. Right now I'm doing it myself. But as a prophet, all I do is, Lord, the Richland County Sheriff Department needs help and please. And that's the way I do it. I bolt them all together. I would like, if you can, go ahead and take another one or two. We have a young lady here that said that she's been praying for them, and this August was the person's birthday, and so she sent them a birthday card. And it's always appreciated. Our people in the law enforcement are kind of underlooked, undercared for. I have cousins and I have friends that are policemen. So if you can, grab one from me. Now, does anybody else have anything they want to say? All right, with that said, I will get out of your way, and
thanks. I just want to add my welcome to you here in the sanctuary on this 13th Sunday after Pentecost, and to those of you worshiping with us on Zoom this morning. We're delighted that you are tuning in as well. Just a pastoral care update for you, Pastor Jim Nichols did get a report on the biopsy of the growth that was found in the colon, and it is cancerous. They are doing more tests to see if it has metastasized. And so we want to continue to hold them very close in our prayers. Dear friend of Charles and Sharon, Dr. John Ferguson died, and so wanted to acknowledge that as well. And then I want to end my comments with some really, really exciting news. We have 7 young people going to Lutheridge in September to a Faith Alive weekend, which is a part of a confirmation program. 7. Robin is a key to that, and I'm just delighted that we can take 7 young people to Lutheridge for a weekend. So we need to rejoice in that. So thanks again for being here, for coming to worship with us. And it's time now for us to center ourselves on that worship, take that breath, and experience the presence of God. Thank you. Please stand as you are able for the order for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven. Amen. Holy Spirit, be with you all. Please pray with me the prayer of the day. Holy God, your word feeds your people with life that is eternal. Direct our choices and preserve us in your truth, that renouncing what is false and evil, we may live in you through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated, and I've invited Robin this morning to come forward and share with you the snack pack ministry here that we have going. It's an exciting thing that takes care of our children, and so it seemed the right thing to do. Thanks, Robin.
Morning, everyone. Good morning. Thanks for having me up here today, Pastor Jane. You know, the snack pack ministry we've been doing for several years now. It actually started with Joe Studemeyer and kind of his vision for an outreach program that we could do to really affect our community. And one of the reasons that this came up is during kind of our reflection time, talking about how we have impacted our community, the question was raised, if Chrisis Victor were no longer here, would anybody miss us? Would anybody in this community miss us? And the truth is that they would, that over the last several years, that as Bear mentioned, we have gone from packing 11 snack packs a week, which at the very beginning, I remember sitting in a council meeting going, well, yeah, I think we could do that. And now we pack as many as 74 snack packs a week. So it varies up and down. Students need changes. And unfortunately, because of the nature of the lifestyle that a lot of those children lead, they don't stay at the same schools. So the numbers go up and down from week to week. But we have a very dedicated group of individuals that are willing to come to the church each week or stay after church. We pack the bags. We have another dedicated group of individuals that make the bags up for us. And yet another dedicated group of individuals that are certain to make sure that those bags get delivered each week. And it really has a huge impact on our community. And this is something that not just the volunteers that actually pack and deliver the bags do, it's something that all of you participate in. When you give money to the snack pack program, 100% of it goes to the bags. Nobody's getting paid to do any of the work that goes along with it. All of that money, it goes right into the food that goes into the bag. So what is a snack pack? A snack pack is a variety of 16 items that get put in a plastic grocery bag that's doubled up so that it doesn't rip as a child takes it home, and is meant for the child to have over the weekend when there's less access to the breakfast and lunch that they're probably getting for little or no cost at school. And the purpose of that is not just so that they can eat on the weekend, though that's an important part. It's really so that when they show up to school on Monday morning, that they're not so hungry that they can't even think about trying to learn that day. And so it's really trying to put a break in that cycle of they're already struggling. If we can have food in their bellies on Monday morning, or you know, at least get them to that first breakfast on Monday morning, then they have a better opportunity to learn and break and help to break that cycle where we don't have anything and then we go to school, we can't even learn while we're there, and so on. So it's a really important ministry. And so I just jotted down a couple numbers, and you're going to see these kind of floating around. I just updated them because prices have changed over time. And especially in the last year, it's been very difficult to get some of the items that we regularly put in these snack packs. So each bag that we pack costs about $4.68 worth of food to put in those bags, which is remarkable when you think about it. It's 16 things in a bag and it's only $4.68. But if you multiply that by 70, which is probably the average number over the course of the year that we pack, that's $327.53 that it costs each week for us to make sure that we have a bag for each child that is on our list. And then the other part, the part that I actually just thought of and then did a quick calculation, is that over the course of a school year, 36 weeks of school, and there are some weeks that, you know, they don't need the bags for whatever reason. Maybe they get too many or the children aren't there and can't take them home. That we pack about over 2,000 snack packs a year. So that's walking around in a circle in the snack pack room over and over and over again, for those of you that don't realize how those bags are packed. So it's a really exciting ministry. It's something that really impacts our community. We have two elementary schools. One that last year, Mid Carolina Electric Co-op came to us and said, hey, we heard that y'all pack snack packs and we have a school that we're willing to sponsor if y'all can do the work. And so we gladly took that on. I mean, it's an easy, you know, look around the group of people that are volunteering and saying, hey, are y'all willing to pack, you know, 10 or 15 more bags for this year? They're going to be paid for. Oh yeah, definitely. You know, no problem. So we're excited about this ministry. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of dedication from the people that do it, because, you know, you don't want to tell a kid that they're going to have some food over the weekend and then, oh, oops, something came up and I can't get those bags made. But we are always looking for more people that would like to be involved. We would love for people to make donations, either, you know, financial contributions, or if you would rather drop off items that are in the bags, you're welcome to do that. The way that we keep the costs low in terms of, you know, the numbers that I gave you is by buying it in bulk at Sam's Club or Costco. And that seems to work pretty well. But however you can help this ministry, it's a powerful ministry. And you know, it's a way that we are relevant in our community and truly making a difference in the lives of the kids that really live right around here. So as I mentioned, two elementary schools, a middle school and a high school. So it's not a specific thing to one age group. It's all kids in this area. So
that's it. Thanks, Ronnie. Thanks so much. Powerful way for us to be the church out into the world. Let's do our usual prayer. Dear God, thank you for snack packs. Thank you for the ministry of this congregation that reaches out to feed hungry children. Bless them and nurture them so that they might grow in faith. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
First reading for today is from the 24th chapter of Joshua. Then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Now therefore revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight. He protected us along all the way that we went and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Just will be punished.
The second reading is from the sixth chapter of Ephesians. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever. He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, this teaching is difficult. Who can accept it? But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you, there are some who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, for this reason, I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father. Because of this, many of his disciples came back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, do you also wish to go away? Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God, the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. As you may know, in our Lutheran tradition, our appointed readings for each Sunday come to us through a resource called the Lectionary for Worship. There are three of them. In year A, the gospel comes primarily from Matthew. Year B, Mark. Year C, Luke. And the gospel of John is intertwined in and among all three cycles. And we are currently in cycle B. So most of our readings throughout this church year have come from Mark, with readings from John at designated times, like, for example, the past several Sundays, where the sixth chapter of John has been our gospel reading. That assigned reading, that gospel reading, and always serves as the primary reading. And then the other three, first and second readings in the psalm, all relate in some way to that gospel reading. And sometimes that relationship is obvious, and at other times it's a little more difficult to discern. And sometimes those readings just seem to speak directly to what's happening in the world or in our nation or in our community or even in our congregation. And today, the parallels between and among the first reading and the gospel, and the parallels between those readings and Christus Victor are uncanny, and more likely that word should be providential. In the first reading in the gospel, both the Israelites and the followers of Jesus are on the cusp of major discernment-making time. They've come to pivotal points in their lives of faith, and they must choose from the options that are before them. And that's exactly where Christus Victor is. You are on the cusp of major decision-making time, and you must choose between options that are before you. Last Sunday morning, you gathered to talk about your history. This past Thursday evening, you gathered to hear and discuss the results of the Congregational Vitality Survey and to hear from Bishop Abishur how you now proceed in the call process. And now you, too, have some choices to make. So the parallels are significant. Let's take a look, starting with that first reading from Joshua. As those verses open, the Israelites, finally, after years of wandering in the wilderness, have crossed the River Jordan. They stand now on that promised land so long ago promised to Abraham and descendants. 40 years, Moses has led them out of slavery in Egypt, across the Red Sea, and by way of the wilderness of Sinai toward Canaan, that promised land. The fact that this wasn't the shortest route isn't the only reason it took them so long. The people began grumbling almost immediately. They got hungry and thirsty. They first blamed Moses, then God. They built a golden calf to worship while Moses was on Mount Sinai receiving the Ten Commandments. They worshiped other pagan gods. They integrated into foreign cultures and forgot who they were. And they forgot their God. And so they wandered, sometimes aimlessly, for 40 years. Moses died, and Joshua became their appointed leader. And in the verses not read this morning, God recalls for them their history, how God delivered them from the hands of the Egyptians, fought battles for them, preserved them from the hands of their enemies, and gave them the land on which they are now standing. Joshua takes them to Shechem, the place where Abraham first received that promise. They have arrived, Joshua tells them, at a pivotal point of major discernment. It's time, he tells them, to put away their idol worship and their love of pagan ways and pledge their allegiance to Israel's God and to serve God and God alone in word and in deed. And if you are unwilling to do that, Joshua says, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your ancestors served in the wilderness beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now live. But as for me, Joshua says, as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. The time of major discernment making had come. And the people answered that they too will choose to serve the Lord. And then in our gospel reading from John today, these last few verses of chapter 6, that bread of life chapter, we find the disciples and other followers of Jesus in much the same place as those Israelites. Ever since the feeding of the 5,000, crowds have followed Jesus everywhere, asking for more bread, asking for another sign that he is who he says he is. And his response has been, I am the bread of life. I am the bread that came down from heaven. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. And in our reading for today, Jesus raises the ante. Unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in me. Now, there's already been some grumbling. Isn't this Mary and Joseph's boy? Who does he think he is? You see, they know the message of the prophets of old. They know God's promise to raise up a king from the lineage of David. They know their history. So Jesus, this hometown boy, he can't be the promised Messiah, can he? And now, with all this talk about eating his flesh and drinking his blood, it's just too much. It's too much for many of his followers. Hearing that literally, rather than understanding that he's talking about a total immersion, a baptism, if you will, into his death and resurrection, that teaching was just too much. And many turned back and no longer went about with him. Then Jesus turns to the 12 and, almost echoing Joshua of old, asks, "Do you too wish to go away? You choose. You choose this day who you will follow." Their moment of discernment making has come, and Peter, echoing the Israelites of old, responds with the words we often sing in our gospel affirmation: "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life." So now we come to Christus Victor Lutheran Church. And do you see the parallel? This congregation, too, is on the cusp of some major discernment-making time. And not just the discernment of the call of a pastor, but the discernment of who God is calling you to be in this time and in this place. There's been lots of good conversation about both of these in last Sunday's history conversation and Thursday night's review of the Congregational Vitality Inventory. In last Sunday's history conversation, you recall many memorable moments in this church's history. The days when these halls were full of children and young people. The need to build because you were outgrowing the space. The purchase and installation of the organ. The strong leadership of councils throughout the years. Strong worship and strong music. Community outreach like snack packs beyond the local community. The paying off of the mortgage by an anonymous giver. National youth gatherings, the large number of pastors produced by this congregation. I think we named 6 or 7 that night. Amazing, amazing. The card and phone ministry, all God-defining moments in the history of this congregation, along with some bumps in the road along the way, controversies which have led some people to leave the congregation. Declining membership, the need for more families with youth children, with young children and youth, declining numbers actively involved in various ministries of the congregation, and of course, the impact of COVID. And at Thursday evening's gathering, you heard about the strengths of this congregation that emerged from that congregational vitality survey, fellowship, and relationships, and most of all, a congregation that experiences God's presence. On the other hand, you learn there is opportunity for growth in such areas as sense of mission and lay leadership. And then that evening's conversation concluded with some words from Bishop Abishur about the call process you are now almost ready to begin. She reminded you that God is already preparing the one who will be called to serve this congregation in its next years of ministry and of your need to pray for that pastor. She pointed out how it is that the ministry site profile sheds light on the mission and vision of this congregation, its strengths and its growing edges. And therefore, she said, it is important to discern that mission and vision among yourselves, because that information guides her and her staff in the identification of possible candidates for call. So it is an exciting time for you. Just as the Israelites and the disciples, you too are at a major discernment-making time. And just like them, you too must choose this day whom you will serve. You too must answer Jesus' question, "Do you also wish to go away?" Joshua and Jesus both say to you, choose this day whom you will serve. You see, there are a lot of pagan gods and pagan cultures out there calling for you to follow. Maybe more so in this 21st century that we live in rather than in Joshua's day. It's easy at times to make your own God, as did the Israelites. It's easy at times to say, this is too hard for us. It's easy to long to go back to the past, like the Israelites. They wanted things the way they used to be, even if it meant going back into slavery. It's easy to be scared about what
eating this flesh and drinking this blood means, because what it means is
that our Christian faith, our Christian teachings define us and shape us. It's our identity as a baptized child of God and nothing else that shapes and defines us and moves us to live as God's people in this world. But you must choose with prayer and patience. You must listen to the Spirit and choose to go where the Spirit of God is leading. I'd like to close with one of my favorite prayers in the evening prayer service in our ELW. Oh God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading and your love supporting us. Amen.
Yeah.
It is at this time that you are invited to sit and ponder for a couple of minutes our worship experience each Sunday. How has God spoken to you individually? Certainly important, but maybe more so now as we begin this journey into discernment time. How is God speaking to this congregation through this worship service this morning? The liturgy, the hymns, the music, the sermon, scripture readings. How is God speaking so that we may be the people God is calling us to be? Take a couple of minutes to reflect on that. With the whole church, we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for our prayers. Children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of courage, bless all leaders of your church. Especially this morning, we pause to pray for our council and call committee as they prepare to complete that ministry site profile and get ready then to receive names of candidates. Make them and all of us ready to proclaim the gospel of peace and strengthen us to preach your loving word. Lord, in your mercy, God of creation, bless fields and orchards, protect the land from drought and bring life-giving rain to support growth. Instruct your people in wise treatment of the world you have provided for all your creatures. We pause this moment to pray for Haiti, the people there who have suffered such devastation from hurricanes and rains. And we pray for friends and family in the Northeast as they face the impact of a hurricane there. Lord, in your mercy, God of community, bless all who seek justice between nations and peoples. Give guidance to bridge builders, heal divisions, and inspire cooperation in times of crisis, disaster, and war. And so we especially this morning lift before you, God, Afghanistan. We pray for that nation. We pray for ways of healing. We pray for ways of peace. We surely pray for safety for all those in harm's way. Lord, in your mercy, God of compassion, bless all who are in any need. Accompany all who are lonely and feeling abandoned, and remind them of your abiding presence. Accompany all who are persecuted and exploited, and open us to their cries. We remember especially this morning Donna Brown, Susan Cafferty, Barbara Chambers, the family of Dr. John Ferguson, Sharon Johnson, Nolan McKinley, Cheryl Myers, Pastor Jim Nichols, Aubrey Rowe, Jeff Peters, Donnie Schroeder, Megan Schroeder, Don Dykus, Dave Davis. And gracious God, we cannot pray this morning without lifting up the COVID pandemic. It is raging again through our people in our country and across the world. We pray for those suffering with COVID. We pray for the families of those who have died. We pray for all our healthcare providers, particularly hospital staff that are now overburdened and shutting down to other surgeries. We pray that somehow we may do the things which will lead us to the containment of this virus. Lord, in your mercy, we pray this day, as we have been during this month of August, for the Japan Evangelical Lutheran Church. We pray the prayers that are being prayed across our church. Merciful God, let us be your servant to follow what Jesus taught us to be, peacemakers among people and nations, and bless us through the fruits of peace and love on earth. Plant in our hearts the seeds of shalom and grow them with your holy water, so that we are prepared to be your instrument and bloom flowers of your peace. God of the nations, we pray that you would inspire us to create a peaceful world, and that our will and hope for peace be enriched by the resurrection life of Jesus Christ and the breath of the Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, we pray this day, gracious God, for Luther Ridge. It's in turmoil right now. Lots of changes, lots of issues arising. We pray for Bishop Leonard Bullock, who will be serving as the interim executive director. We pray for that board. We pray for all staff. And we pray that you will open eyes and hearts to hear where it is you are leading that ministry. Lord, in your mercy. And as always, gracious God, we pray this day for whom no one prays. You call us to be little Christ to them. Let us do that. Let them see your grace and mercy and love in us. And in so doing, may we see in them one of your beloved children. Lord, in your mercy, receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. May we share that peace. We come now to that part of the service where, having received from God the gifts of worship and all our earthly blessings, we pause to honor that time in our order of worship, where ordinarily we would give our financial offerings to God in gratitude and for the undergirding of the ministries of this congregation and the wider church. Here in the sanctuary, worshipers have placed their offerings in the plate located at the baptismal font as they entered for worship. Those of you worshiping with us on Zoom are invited at this time to place your offerings in a basket there at your family altar, and then bring them by the church and place it in the locked outside mailbox. You may also give in many various ways online, and we thank you for your gifts.
Thank you.
Please stand. Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Reminded to hold your small chalice as you hear the words of institution as we consecrate our elements. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, you we praise and glorify, you we worship and adore. You formed the earth from chaos, you encircled the globe with air, you created fire for warmth and light, you nourished the lands with water. You molded us in your image, and with mercy higher than the mountains, with grace deeper than the seas, you blessed the Israelites and cherished them as your own, that also we, estranged and dying, might be adopted to live in your spirit. You called to us through the life and death of Jesus. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for everyone for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together, as the body of Christ, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. With this bread and cup, we remember your Son, the firstborn of your new creation. We remember his life lived for others and his death and resurrection, which renews the face of the earth. We await his coming when, with the world made perfect through your wisdom, all our sins and sorrows will be no more. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, holy and merciful one, holy and compassionate, send upon us and this meal your Holy Spirit, whose breath revives us for life, whose fire rouses us to love. Enfold in your arms all who share this holy food. Nurture in us the fruits of the Spirit, that we may be a living tree, sharing your bounty with all the world. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Holy and benevolent God, receive our praise and petitions as Jesus received the cry of the needy, and fill us with your blessing until, needy no more and bound to you in love, we feast forever in the triumph of the Lamb, through whom all glory and honor is yours, O God, O living one, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. Come. Thanks be to God. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. The blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. in peace. You are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.